so many herbivorous insect species, you may wonder, what can a plant do to deter insect feeding? Well, plants use a variety of defenses for protection against herbivory. As plants can't run away from their attackers, physical and chemical plant defenses are common, and some even recruit natural enemies of the attacking insect herbivore to provide indirect protection to the plant. Physical plant defenses are morphological characteristics that inhibit exploitation of the plant by insect herbivores. Small hairs on the leaves and stems of the plants, called trichomes, can deter small insects from feeding and oviposition as they make plant surfaces difficult to access. The defense provided by trichomes is not only physical, though, as many of them have glands that produce or store chemical deterrents that further ward off insect herbivores. Leaf toughness is another plant trait that can protect plants against herbivory. The toughness of leaves can physically hinder feeding by leaf chewers or insects with piercing, sucking mouthparts. This is usually accomplished through increased lignin and cellulose content in the leaves, compounds which are tough and indigestible to many insects. The toughness of leaves can also change with plant phenology throughout the growing season. Phenology refers to the periodically occurring events in plant and animal life cycles that are influenced by variations in climate and environmental factors, especially temperature. Many insects that defoliate trees are most active in the spring, when leaves are more nutritious and less tough. Some plants, like grasses, have silica in their leaves that can act as a physical defense against insect herbivores. The presence of silica within plant cell walls fortifies the mechanical barrier against pathogen and herbivore attacks. This defense is particularly effective against insects that bore into plant tissue, such as stem-boring moth larvae, as silica slows the entry time of insects into the plant. The more time the insect is forced to remain outside the plant, the greater its exposure to external biotic and abiotic threats. Silica deposition also reduces digestibility and increases the abrasiveness of plant tissues, which can have severe consequences for the digestive system of some insect herbivores. For example, the mandibles of rice stem-boring moth larvae become damaged after they feed on rice plants with high silica content. This can inhibit feeding activity, at least until the next molt. Trees, especially coniferous trees, have a defense against insect herbivores that is both physical and chemical in nature, called resin, or pitch. If you've ever played the violin, or even just got your hands sticky by touching the bark on a conifer tree, you'll already be familiar with this particular defense. In addition to chemical properties that make resin toxic to insects, resin can physically push burrowing insects out of the tree and block pathogens from entering an open wound. Plant resistance that deters insect feeding is called non-preference because the defense mechanism reduces the insect's preference for using a particular plant without impacting the insect's metabolism. While non-preference resistance can include chemical defenses, it is often associated with physical defenses. Chemical defenses used by plants involve compounds called secondary plant metabolites. These chemicals are not involved in plant growth or any regular plant metabolic processes. Instead, they can be used by the plant to defend against herbivores. Secondary metabolites can directly deter insect feeding and oviposition activities or interrupt digestive processes in insects. Plant resistance that operates through metabolic disruption is referred to as antibiosis. Many secondary plant metabolites form the basis of commercial insecticides because they are toxic to insects. Furthermore, the natural defensive traits of plants can be enhanced in crop plants through selective breeding. Secondary plant metabolites can also act as an indirect defense against herbivorous insects. Plants can change the bouquet of chemicals that they release after attack by an insect herbivore. These chemicals can signal the presence of an insect herbivore and attract natural enemies of the herbivores, such as predators or parasitoids. The chemical profile released by plants can differ by species and type of herbivore damage it experiences. Recent research has shown that a single type of plant can release different compounds when fed upon by different insect herbivores. In these cases, the production of specific plant chemicals may even be induced by compounds in the insect's saliva. We spoke with our resident expert on plant chemical defenses, Dr. Nadir Erbilgin. He describes the ways plants deal with insect attacks and how plant defensive chemistry can have far-reaching impacts on the natural world around us.
I'm a professor in forest health or forest entomology and pathology, basically, or chemical ecology at the University of Alberta, Department of Renewable Resources. What I do, I'm a chemical ecologist in training, especially the bark beetle ecologist. I look at the chemical interactions between the plants and bark beetles in general in North America as well as in Europe, and some part of my research involves in Asia. Study any forest insects, but mainly focus on the bark beetles because of their really economically important, ecologically important species throughout the world. They are the major tree-killing insects pretty much everywhere in the world. 50% of my research really focuses on mountain pine beetle. When I look at the, what are the key chemicals, host chemicals that drive mountain pine beetle tree interactions. In this case, I look at this chemical classes called monoterpenes. This is one of the classes of terpenoids chemicals. Recognition is I think, the most important part of evolution. If the host plants cannot recognize their enemy, they're in big trouble. That's exactly what's happening right now with lots of trees. Exotic pathogens and insects are coming and killing North American plants. Why? Because North American plants don't recognize them, what it is. That's the reason they cannot react to it. If they do, they can produce defensive compounds. Roles of chemicals really depending on their concentrations. Monoterpenes, for example, at the high concentrations can be highly toxic to the insects, but the lower concentration, they could be benefiting the insects. Bark beetles in general are associated with a number of symbiotic fungal organisms, in addition to the bacteria and yeasts and some nematodes, but we know much about the plant, the fungal interaction in when we're dealing with the bark beetles. Interaction is very interesting. Some of the chemicals that could be toxic to insects, but may not be toxic to their symbiotic fungi, or vice versa. Some of the compounds that we found, highly toxic to the fungus, but is not so much the bark beetles. It really varies by environment, varies with age, varies with the plant species, and there are a lot of variations even within a species because of phenotypic differences, environmental differences, differences in age, as well as some genetic differences that we have really very little understanding. Their exploitation is really depending on their evolutionary interactions. Let's give an example for mountain pine beetle. Mountain pine beetle may use some of these compounds to produce pheromones. You know, alpha pinene, one of the most abundant compound in large ball pine, for example. And they use their precursor, alpha pinene precursor, one of the female aggregation pheromone, transverbenol. It's beautiful. So far, we covered the constitutive defenses, which is present in the trees all the time, but induced defenses usually happens when the plants are attacked by bark beetles or defoliators or even the pathogens. There is some commonality among these defensive responses, but there are also differences. When the tree is attacked by stem versus foliage, their responses will be different because of they have evolved with the organisms that they recognize it, actually. They recognize the threat. Plant response, plant defense is strongly tied to the environment. You know, one of the biggest environmental factor, people study drought. Drought is really the major limiting factor for plants, especially in places like Alberta, because we are really a drought-prone province. Several factors affect plant insect interaction. Is one of them is drought, as I mentioned before. If the plants are stressed because they are limited access to water, they have less defensive capacity. Why they are important? I will say two reasons. First, they attack the very vital plant tissues, in this case, the phloem. They carry the carbon from foliage to the remaining portion of stem and the roots. We have a xylem. Xylem is mainly deal with the water transportation, even though there are good evidence that they may also transfer nutrients. So this is very vital. If you cut off this phloem, what's going to happen? Right? You're cutting off the nutrient supply for the keeping the trees green. That's one factor. And the second thing is they are associated with this staining fungi. It's a really, bark beetles are perfect tree-killing insects. Absolutely tree-killing organisms, but they don't achieve by themselves. They're always associated with other organisms. In this case, this symbiotic fungi. This is what happens. When the bark beetle attack the trees, they feed on the phloem. They cut off it. And at the same time, they introduce fungi into the phloem. The fungi grow from the xylem. What this happens, they're cutting off both nutrient flow and water flow at the same time, and trees basically can defend a certain amount of time, but after that they cannot because there's no more resources. In order to produce defensive compounds, they have to access resources. I like mayfly. My favorite insect is really mayfly. It's nothing to do with the bark beetles. It's a beautiful insect. They have aquatic larva, really vicious too. But the adults, summertime, usually they appear after rain in May. Millions of them, if you are lucky, you can see just single day, thousands of them, millions of them emerges. They are really beautiful. They have a big white wings, very beautiful tails. It's like a millions of, I don't know, it's like a wedding or the gowns that, you know, people wear. I don't know, it's just so beautiful everywhere you can see it. And they don't live long, just live only 1 or 2 days, and they die short after. Mayfly is my favorite insect.
Strange though it might seem, plants can even form symbiotic relationships with non-herbivorous insects to defend against herbivory. An example of this close cooperation between species occurs in ant plants, or myrmecophytes. These specialized plants have a mutualistic association with ants. The plant often provides shelter for the ants in specialized cavities called domatia. They can also provide ants with extra food sources in the form of proteinaceous growths called Belthian bodies, as well as carbohydrate sources from nectar reservoirs. These are known as extrafloral nectaries because they exist outside of the floral structures of the plant. The plant also receives many benefits from its relationship with the ants. For instance, the ants can protect the plants from various insect herbivores, and, working in concert, can even attack large vertebrate herbivores. The plant also obtains extra nutrients from the decomposition of the ants and their wastes on or around the plant. Finally, the ants can help the plant with seed dispersal and are motivated to collect the seeds by the presence of nutritious structures on the outside of the seeds that the ants eat. The ants then carry these seeds into underground nests where they consume the nutritious structures and leave the seeds to sprout in their new environment. If you thought the ant plants were cool, wait until you hear about the mimosa plant. It is also called the sensitive plant, and for good reason. This plant exhibits a behavioral defense mechanism in which the leaves fold rapidly in response to mechanical stimulation. By closing its leaves suddenly, the plant can cause a large insect to fall off of the plant or to be startled by the plant's movement. The leaves also look like a less sizable meal when folded, and therefore will be less appealing to herbivorous insects. Furthermore, sharp spines on the plant's stem are exposed when the leaves are folded, which serve as a deterrence against large herbivores. While some other plants are capable of rapid movement, such as the Venus flytrap, the mimosa plant may be one of the very few plants that uses rapid movement to defend against herbivory. That said, there remains no conclusive evidence that this plant response evolved for this specific purpose. Plants produce an incredible range of defenses to protect themselves from herbivores. While plants may manipulate defenses in response to a single type of herbivore, multiple herbivores may feed on a single plant at the same time, making the potential plant-insect interactions extremely complex. Despite these defenses, most insects still feed on plants. We'll look at how insect herbivores get around these defenses and exploit plant tissue by examining feeding gills in the next lesson.